you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
All right, let's get straight into it. So we're continuing our new series, I Am Jesus. I'm not Jesus, and you need to be very thankful that I am not Jesus. Doesn't even bear thinking about it, does it? So we're looking at the covenant name of God because Jesus reminded us that that's who he is and that's how he's always going to be known. So the question we've been asking the last 2 weeks is, who is Jesus to you? And I know it sounds obvious, and I know that you're probably thinking, well, you know, Jesus is my Savior. Yeah, I understand that. But there are a lot of things that Jesus wants to be to us that maybe he's not yet to us. There are areas of our lives that maybe we haven't fully surrendered to him. Getting a bit quiet in this place. I said last week that in order to become who we truly are, we need to discover who he really is. So we're looking at the 7 I Am statements that Jesus made in the book of John, which really express the kind of relationship that he wants with each one of us. Last week, we looked at the first I Am, which was, I am the bread of life. And we learned a lot about bread. How many of you have eaten bread this week? Okay, how many of you started eating bread this week because of last week's message? Well, that's good. I'm not responsible for any weight gain. All right. So this week we move on to I Am 2, which is I am the light of the world. Before we look at that scripture, I thought this would be a great opportunity to share a few light bulb jokes. So how many evolutionists does it take to change a light bulb? Just one, but it will take 1 million years. How many psychiatrists does it take to change a light bulb? Again, only one, but the light bulb is really got to want to change. I like this one. How many folk musicians does it take to change a light bulb? 5. One to change the bulb, and 4 to write songs about how much better the old bulb was. Liz, forgive me for this one. How many Scotsmen does it take to change a light bulb? Scotsmen don't change light bulbs. It's cheaper to sit in the dark. Oh, I'm in trouble now. I'm in trouble now. John 8 and verse 12. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And if you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. Light is essential for life. I wonder whether you realize how essential light is for life. I guess we all forget because we're so used to light being there. You know, if we didn't have light today, we'd be sat in darkness, literally in this place, because we light up the place. So we're grateful for light today. You know, when we had a light go a couple of weeks ago, it got a bit dim in here. And that was just one light. You think that there's lots of stage lights. They're very bright. They do light us up. But it's incredible how that one light made one area of the stage dim. That's the power of light. See, light kickstarts food chains both on land and sea. Light provides sustenance for the survival of plankton in the ocean. Light acts as a catalyst during photosynthesis in plants. In fact, light is the plant's only source of energy. So they're actually entirely dependent on light. Light is the most important tool of guidance. We need light to see and go about our daily activities. I bet you didn't know this, but the invention of fire was man's attempt to substitute the light of the day while fighting the darkness of the night. We think of fires being things that we cook things on. Of course, it was used for that as well, but it was actually to light the darkness. Light is also an effective means of communication. Beacons, lasers, reflective devices, flashlights, they all prove essential in the conveyance of messages. Light is so important that with technological advancements, we're discovering beneficial uses of light, such as solar power. You might not know this. You might have heard of the guy Elon Musk. He's the guy who just put the SpaceX rocket up into space and brought it back down successfully. He's the guy that makes Tesla electric cars. He's also the guy that's developed something that's happening this month. You've heard of solar panels. There's a lot of houses in our areas that have solar panels. He has developed a solar roof tile. And it's essentially just a piece of glass that looks like your roof tile. So your entire roof in the future will be able to generate your energy. No solar panels, just solar roof tiles. And he claims it's going to be cheaper than renewing your roof along with your electric bill. So we're moving into times that are very exciting, but we're using the light that's been there for thousands of years. It's amazing, isn't it, that we're only just discovering the power of light. Light is, in fact, the primary essence which governs and allows for all life on this planet. If we receive no light from the sun, the Earth's temperature would substantially drop in a very short period of time, and all life on this planet would quickly become extinct. The light from the sun supports all life forms by heating the planet and making it habitable, but also empowers nature to support all of its forms of life. In addition, it's like being at school, isn't it? But we're learning something today which will really help us understand what Jesus was really meaning. Because I think sometimes we can read scripture and we just look at the spiritual, and that's great. But we have to understand the practical. We have to understand the natural. Do you know what? They found sunlight actually helped prevent 24 types of cancer. Now, we've heard that it brings on cancer, and it does. It does bring on skin cancer. That's why we have to protect. But there are 24 types of cancer that it helps prevent. Sunlight improved, in some tests, some skin conditions. Sunlight strengthens our bones. Sunlight helps you concentrate better. Sunlight improves, would you believe, your eyesight? I'm not suggesting you should go out and look at the sun because that's dangerous too. But evidently, it helps our eyesight. Sunlight promotes faster healing. Sunlight helps you sleep sounder. Didn't work last night, but hey, maybe I wasn't out in the sun enough. Sunlight encourages healthier weight. Makes sense. Maybe you don't feel like eating so much when the sun's shining. Maybe you feel like going out for a jog. Or maybe not. And one study found that sunlight actually increases level of a natural antidepressant in the brain. And on sunny days, the brain produces more of the mood-lifting chemical serotonin than on darker days. So I would suggest you make the most of the sun when you get out of church today. Enjoy it. Get the sun into your soul. and it might cheer you up. Light is an essential part of everyday life, and it's impossible to live without it. So we're only really beginning to understand the half of what God said in Genesis 1 and verse 3, going right back to the beginning of the book where he said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. We didn't understand what that really meant until we started to discover how essential light really is. And just like God, Jesus was also making a huge statement when he said, "I am the light of the world." I like the way the Message puts it. "I am the world's light. No one who follows me stumbles around in the darkness. I provide plenty of light to live in." I love that last line. "I provide plenty of light to live in." So Jesus was essentially saying he's our light source, our only light source spiritually. Because Jesus brings light in every situation, through every challenge, and to every circumstance. And even though we'll still go through the dark times and we'll end up in dark places, he will always provide light. It's not because there can't be light. It's because we're keeping the light out. There's always, he says, enough light for you to live in. And we won't be in complete darkness. We don't have to be in complete darkness because his presence will provide light. And it's amazing how such little light changes so much darkness. When you get a power cut, I guess we don't run for candles anymore, because we've all got phones. So we use our phone, and we got a little LED torch on our phone, a little bulb that you can hardly see. But isn't it amazing? If I put that on right now, the light that that would produce. You know, when we were filming Benny Bunny, or whatever we've called the bunny, I think it's Benny, we went through several names. We had to have a committee meeting about, you know, the bunny's name. So Benny Bunny will be at church next week. But we were talking about Benny Bunny, and we were needing to film Benny Bunny in another church, in another building, and the light wasn't good in there. It was all yellow light. So we literally all got our phones out, and we used our phone to light up Benny Bunny. It's amazing what a phone will do. And little light makes a huge difference to much darkness. Just a little light enables us to instantly see better. Just a little light gives us a different perspective on the darkness that we're experiencing. We see differently because we see things in a different light. We see more clearly because everything's clearer when there's some light. His light brings clarity to confusion. It brings belief to doubt. It brings faith to fear. It brings hope to despair. It's amazing what his light does in our lives, and we don't even realize it, and we don't remember it, and we don't thank him for it. His light comforts us when we're lonely. It directs us when we're lost. It encourages us when we're disappointed. It lifts us when we're down. Isn't his light amazing? I think we should give him a round of applause for his light today. I think we should stand on our feet and give him praise that he is the light of the world. Come on, give him the praise that is due to his name today. Thank you, Jesus. You are the light of the world, and what that really means to us. We are so grateful that you are the light of the world. I love that. You are the light of the world. It wasn't about them being the light of the world. He is now the light of the world. He's the light that is needed in this dark world. I believe heaven just got really excited when you all got on your feet. When you made the effort to get on your feet and give him praise, I tell you, heaven's just going, yeah! Because you're showing your honor to God. You're showing your praise. You're showing. It's a demonstration of what you believe on the inside. And it's a great opportunity to praise Him with all that we are. I don't like church where we just sit down all the time. I don't like church that's quiet anymore. I grew up in quite a quiet church. It's not quiet nowadays, but it was then. I'm glad they've got a little bit more rowdy over the years. But you know, when I read Psalms are rowdy. I know there are times when the psalmist was quiet, and there's times that we need to be quiet. I'm not saying we shouldn't have quiet times, and we have quiet times sometimes in our worship. But there is also a need for us to praise Him with everything that we are and say, yes. Thank you, Jesus. There's something we need to grasp from this scripture. I was preparing this and feeling it was a little bit like treacle, and I wasn't really kind of getting on very well, and I couldn't understand why, and then I found out. That's your 20-minute warning. We're going somewhere. You might not like where we're going, but I didn't come up with the message. So don't blame the messenger. We're going somewhere that if you will receive the message today, God will really help you. I believe this could set some people free in a way that you've never got set free before. I tell you why, because we're going to challenge areas that other people don't want to talk about. We're going to challenge areas that you don't want to talk about. All right. Something that I read here that really sums up what I want to say, which is walking in the light is always a choice. Jesus said, if you follow me. You see, if we read on in John 8 and verse 13, it appears like Jesus is interrupted mid-flow. Nothing worse than being interrupted mid-flow when you're teaching. It says in verse 13, the Pharisees objected. Nothing new there then. All we have is your word on this. We need more than this to go on. Jesus replied, you're right that you only have my word. But you can depend on it being true. I know where I've come from and where I go next. You don't know where I'm from and where I go next. You don't know where I'm from or where I'm headed. You decide everything according to what you can see and touch. I don't make judgments like that. But even if I did, my judgment would be true because I wouldn't make it out of the narrowness of my experience, but in the largeness of the one who sent me, the Father. I love the way he has a little dig in such a subtle way. Well, maybe not so subtle. That fulfills the conditions set down in God's law, because he knows they're trying to trick him. They're trying to catch him out. So he says that fulfills the conditions set down in God's law, that you can count on the testimony of two witnesses. And that is what you have. You have my word, and you have the word of the Father who sent me. They said, well, where is this so-called Father of yours? Jesus said, you're looking right at me and you don't see me. How do you expect to see the Father? If you knew me, you would at the same time know the Father. In other words, you're missing it by a mile. You see, this wasn't just an interruption. It was an objection to what he said about who he was. The problem was who he was claiming to be. I am the light of the world. You got to understand, he made seven statements. I am, I am, I am, I am, I am, I am. I don't know whether that was seven. They were offended because they were living in darkness. They couldn't see him because they wouldn't recognize him. That's really the essence of their objection. They were wanting proof. They were wanting him to prove who his Father was. They were wanting him to prove that what he was saying he was. and that his word wasn't enough. And it brings out a point, because you can only start recognizing the work of Jesus if you start walking in the light of Jesus. You can only start recognizing the work of Jesus if you start walking in the light of Jesus. They were refusing to walk in that light, so they carried on in darkness. Darkness causes us not to be able to recognize Jesus operating in our lives, even when he is. In fact, God can be in the room, but we can't see him. The Holy Spirit can be present, but we can't perceive his presence. Jesus can be staring us in the face, but we don't see him because of darkness, because darkness blocks light. But light brings a perception of his presence. Light brings a perception of his presence. He lights dark places, places that need light. See, I want to suggest that we all potentially have dark places in our lives. And they all need light. And Jesus wants to light up what's been dimmed down. And there's a simple reason for it. And I don't want you to think that, you know, this is a tough message. I want you to see this from a different perspective, because really what we're talking about here is a group of people that were not looking at this message in the right way. Over the last 24 years of preaching, it's very interesting how people respond to the message. And I can pretty much tell whether they're coming from a place of light or darkness through their response. I can understand if they're coming from an attitude of gratitude, because that comes out in conversation. And these people just didn't get it. These guys just did not get it. They were in such darkness. And it wasn't because they couldn't, it's because they refused. I think that's what darkness in our own lives does. It's this rebellion that goes on in our lives, and it just carries on until we do something about it. Rebellion's not just going to disappear, by the way. We have to deal with it. We have to allow Jesus to deal with it. We have to allow Jesus to shine some light on it. So the simple reason for him wanting to light up what's been dimmed down is because nothing healthy grows in the darkness. Think about it. Flowers, trees, fruits, vegetables, things that we want to grow, they all require light. Mold spores, fungi, and moss, things that we don't want to grow, all thrive in dark environments. And we don't want to promote anything or any kind of growth that's found in secret, shady places of our lives. See, darkness is dangerous. Anything in our lives that we're trying to keep secret, anything in our lives that we're trying to keep hidden, is essentially holding us back and will eventually harm us. So if there's any part of your life which is dimmed or hidden, realize this. It's like fungus. It might be small and containable right now, but it won't stay that way for long. It will eventually spread, and it will grow more and more toxic until it poisons you and it harms the people you love. That's what happens to the things that we keep in dark places. The things that are hidden, the things that only we know about, they don't go away until we allow the light to shine on them. Let me put it this way. I said 20 minutes ago that there was a warning. This is what I was warning you about. Just, it might not be the most comfortable message you've ever heard. I would love to just, you know, preach messages every week that just, you know, tickle you and make you feel good. But how many of you know that doesn't get rid of the things that God is trying to deal with? And I'd like to run a mile from, you know, having to prep messages like this. Because I'm like, oh, Lord, really? He's going, well, if you want to see people set free, we got to deal with the things that are holding them back. We got to deal with stuff that's holding you back, Mike. Oh, okay. Let me put it this way. What's hidden hurts you the most. What's hidden hurts you the most. And remember this. It's not going to stay hidden forever. You know the saying. You probably quoted it. It's actually a scripture. I never knew that till later on in life. I'd heard Granny quote it or somebody quote it. I always say Granny because, you know, Granny always quotes, doesn't she? But the Bible quotes it in Numbers 32. Be sure that your sin will find you out. I can remember my mother saying that. You know, if you don't admit to, you know, the things that you're doing wrong, your sin will find you. And I found that. Anybody found that to be true? Actually, yes, that's true. It does, doesn't it? It just catches up on us. And it's not a secret to everybody. Here's the thing. God already knows it. God knows every secret, shady place of our lives and our heart. Nothing escapes his notice. He knows everything. And he's looking at our lives, and he's not looking at our lives to condemn us, but to help us. Did you understand that when he said in John 3:16 that he came to save the world and not condemn it, he was talking about uncovering some of the things in our lives that are condemning us. He's not the condemner. He's the truth. He's the savior. He's the answer. He's the one that comes along and says, listen, there are things that are condemning you, and I want to release you from every secret, shady, dark place so that you will live in the light and the freedom that I have developed for you to live in. See, essentially, that was the problem, the issue with the Pharisees. They didn't want, it wasn't that they couldn't see it, they didn't want to see it. They wouldn't see it because they didn't like what the light exposed. So we all know John 3:16. We love John 3:16. It's a message of hope. But do you know John 3:19? Can you quote John 3:19 to me? God's light came into the world, but people loved the darkness more than the light, for their actions were evil. And all who do evil hate the light and refuse to go near it for fear their sins will be exposed. But those who do what is right come to the light so others can see that they are doing what God wants. They love the dark more than they love the light. Let's not love darkness more than we love light. How do we do that when we refuse to deal with the dark, shady, hidden places of our lives? Because Jesus really wants to work on those places. He wants us to surrender those things. Do you know why? Because he wants us to be the light of the world. How can we shine if we've got dark places? We can only shine. We can only be effective as lights to the world if we face the truth that the light exposes. It says in 1 John 1 and verse 5, God is light, and there is no darkness in him at all. So we are lying if we say we have fellowship with God but go on living in spiritual darkness. We are not practicing the truth. But if we are living in the light as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. What a great passage of scripture. That's good news. Come on, that's the best news you've heard all day. Let me tell you what that really means. God wants to expose our sin privately, because he doesn't want our sin to expose us publicly. I didn't expect many amens for that one, but it might have helped you. God wants to expose our sin privately because he doesn't want our sin to expose us publicly. God isn't doing any of this to condemn us. He's not doing it because he's mad with us. He's doing it because he's madly in love with us. He's doing it because he wants to set us free. And he knows that if we don't deal with these areas will deal with us. They catch up with us. Those things that we think, those things that we do, and maybe some of those things you've done for a long time, it's become habitual. You don't even realize there's anything wrong with it anymore until the light comes in and shines on it, and you're like, whoa, okay. Why? Because we grow. It's like the mold. It's like the fungus just grows, and it becomes part of us. And we then kind of excuse those areas of our life. But if we're truthful, we don't want anybody to know about them. Because when we come to church, we want to put on our Sunday Christian suit, and we don't want some of those things that we think and we do during the week to be known by anybody else, because we'd be ashamed. And God's going, I don't want you to live that way. I don't want you to have almost like a double life. I want to set you free from the things that keep holding you back time and time again, that are hidden in your life. And because they're hidden, the only way they're going to be exposed publicly is if someone comes along and says something about you because they're prophetically speaking into your life. I want to tell you, I've been in lots of prophetic meetings. The one place you don't want your weaknesses exposed is in a prophetic meeting. So I would suggest, as someone who has been in those meetings and experienced that and heard things not just about my life but about others, you know, let's get this sorted with God. Let's just have some Jesus time and say, okay, God, woo, I'm getting it. All right, Lord, I just need to confess that this isn't good for me. Maybe it's something you watch. Maybe it's something you look at. You know, with the internet, we have so much more available to us. And the internet is a wonderful tool to reach people like we're doing now, but you know what? It's also, it's a tool that the enemy can use. Yeah. And we hear it every day on our news, how people have used it in an evil way. And my question is this, where does that all start? It doesn't start where it ends up. It starts in a simple little thing that someone decides to do. Can I encourage you to just get right with God today and to surrender those areas to him so that you don't have to think about how you're going to be. You can just be who God's called you to be, free. There's nothing in your life that's hidden or dark because you've handed it over to God. I'm guessing that this might be just getting through to all of us in some kind of way. And I want you to know that actually I believe we're all in the same boat. I believe that we've all got things. See, if we look at the Pharisees' objection, it wasn't really because they were offended by what he said. It was because of what he was asking. Because he was asking them to trust the truth. And that's essentially the crux of the matter. Because Jesus can bring truth to our lives if we will trust him. He's asking you to trust him with this today because he knows that this is the best thing that you could do. Would you stand with me this morning? I want to just emphasize again what the scripture says. He provides plenty of light to live in. Plenty of light to live in. And if we'll let the light of his truth, because this is what it's really talking about, the truth of the light, shine on our darkness. If we're prepared to say, do you know what? I do love the light more than I love the darkness. Then we'll not only experience his faithfulness to love us and to forgive us and to cleanse us, but we'll also discover his purpose to use us to shine his light to others. It's twofold. It's beneficial to us because it sets us free. It's beneficial to others because it sets others free. And Jesus is trying to get through to this world. And there's never been a time like the time that we live in right now when the world desperately needs Jesus. The world needs Jesus. The world is in a mess. Jesus is the only answer for the world. He was always meant to be the only answer for the world. There is no substitute. There is no world peace without Jesus. Others can strive for it, but it needs to come to from a place of Jesus. So if today you've never experienced that love and that grace and that mercy and that forgiveness, I would be privileged to lead you in a prayer. And we never assume that everybody in the house has prayed a prayer. So we're going to believe and give you the opportunity. And maybe people online that you've heard this message and you know you've got dark places and you know that you don't like those dark places if you're honest. You want to deal with those things. You've never known how to deal with them. Because if we don't have Jesus in our life, then how do we deal with darkness? Because we're without light. But when Jesus enters our life, then we bring the light into the darkness and it changes everything. So I'd be privileged to pray a prayer to lead you into a relationship with Jesus, who can be your light, who will be your light, who will enable you to live in this light that he says there's plenty of. You don't have to live in darkness. You don't have to have hidden areas of your life. You don't have to have secret areas of your life. You can give everything. Actually, you know, that whole thing is ridiculous anyway because he knows, so it's not a secret. A secret is only when no one else knows, but God already knows. So we don't actually have any secrets because God knows. We can't hide anything. We can run, but we can't hide. And that's what maybe some of us have been doing. We've been running from the problem, but we can't hide because God already knows. And it's not because he wants to come down heavy. He wants to actually relieve us of those things that are affecting us the most. So he's not coming down heaven. He's actually coming down light. He's saying, let me lift this burden off of you so that you will know. It will be like a weight lifted off your life. So if you've not ever prayed a prayer asking God into your life, let me just lead you right now and just say these words after me and say, God, I thank you that I've heard about your love and your grace and your mercy, and that there's a purpose for my life, and that I don't have to live with secrets, and I don't have to live with these hidden areas of my life. I can expose them to you today. because they're already exposed to you. But I'm exposing them to you today and saying, God, thank you for the weight that's now going to be lifted by giving my life to you, by confessing my sin, by giving you everything and saying, thank you, Jesus, for lifting these things off of me. Thank you for loving me so much that you would go to a cross and give your life for me. Thank you for your blood that was shed on that cross that cleanses me from all unrighteousness. Your word says, if I will confess my sin, you are faithful and just to forgive me my sin and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. So today I'm cleansed. Today I'm saved. Today I thank you for all that you've done in my life. And the best is yet to come. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, did anybody pray that? Just keep our eyes closed. Did anybody pray that in the house today? And maybe you use that prayer as a kind of recommitment prayer. So if you did kind of echo those words, then raise your hand as well. Praise God. If you did pray that online, would you let us know? We want to help you. We want to encourage you. And we want to help you find a church where you can now grow and develop as a believer. So please get in touch and we will help you in the best way that we can. See, maybe today you already know God. But if you're honest, you've experienced his grace, you've experienced his love, you know his forgiveness. But if you're honest, you're challenged with today's message. If you'd have known what was going to be preached, you might not have come to church. I think you're in good company. But you know this could be the best thing that you've ever heard. Why? Because if it sets you free, this could change your life forever. Do you see why challenging messages sometimes are the best things that we could ever hear? Because while someone's just patting us on the back and telling us how good God is and how good we are, we're not dealing with the bad things in our lives. But the moment that they're talked about is an opportunity for us to go, do you know what? You're right. I'm not going to experience all the good things if I don't deal with the bad things, because they're going to keep pulling me back and pulling me back and pulling me back. And I'll take one step forward and two steps back and one step forward. And that's what it's felt like, I believe, for some people here. It's felt like it's been a struggle. And every time you felt that you're making progress, you took a step back, because the enemy knows of that darkness and he keeps pulling you back into those hidden areas of your life, and he keeps pulling you back into those things that now God has just exposed to you as the problem. So if you're honest, you know that those dark places exist. And right now, it's not about the person next to you. Right now, it's not about you confessing your sin to the person next to you so you can breathe. It's about actually between you and Jesus saying, thank you for shining a light on this today and setting me free. I believe that from this day on, I'm never going to be the same again. Things are going to change. Things are going to change. It can't be the same. Things are going to change. I'm set free. I'm set free from the things that have held me back. I'm set free from the things that the enemy has used time and time again to pull me back. I'm set free. Come on, just surrender them to God and begin to thank him in your heart that he's shone a light on those things today. Those things that you wouldn't see. It wasn't because you couldn't see them, but you didn't want to deal with them. And it's almost like God has given me information without giving me detail. So he's given me information that those things exist, but he hasn't told me the detail of what they are in your life. I know what they are in my life, but I don't know what they are in your life. But isn't it great that God gives someone the information to challenge us without giving us the without giving them the detail, so that we have an opportunity to say, Lord, we just hand this over to you. Father, we stand in your presence, amazed at your grace, amazed at your love, knowing again your mercy afresh, that you say every day, there's fresh mercy. Thank you again, Lord, as we go into this Easter week, for all that you did on the cross that we are experiencing right in this very moment of time. We surrender the dark, hidden places of our lives, the thoughts that we think that no one else knows about. Father, we surrender every single one of them because we want to live in the light and we want to live in the truth and we want to live in more freedom than we previously lived in. So we give you all the praise, we give you all the glory, we give you all the thanks today for what you've done in this place. Lord, we declare that our best days are yet to come, that the best times are still ahead of us, that our best days are still in front of us. Come on, if someone believes that today, give God praise. Thank him for his word. Thank him for the challenge. Thank him that you are set free in Jesus' name.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.